It's great to be here at the Oxford University, which continues to play an important role in the articulation of key global issues as it has for hundreds of years. And when I was coming into this hall with one of yours, a friend of mine, Alex Trotter, who graduated from this school, he was telling me about the history of the school, and more importantly, this place where we are seated or where we are having this conversation. So I consider myself privileged to have the honor to talk with you today. I'd like to appreciate the organizers of this conference for encouraging new thinking and perspectives about Africa across all disciplines. I particularly want to thank Yasmin Kumi for her tireless work to facilitate my presence here today. At times, one can be fairly busy. Today, I want to speak about African capitalism as a catalyst for development in Africa. Today, to me, is a continuation of a conversation I started in November 2014 with a piece in The Economist, where I declared that 2015 would be the year of the African entrepreneur, and backed it up in December by launching the $100 million Tony Elumelu Entrepreneurship Program, also known as TEAP. This program is identifying and providing mentoring, training, networking, and funding for 1,000 African startups per year for the next 10 years. The program kicked off on January 1, 2015, and we had an amazing response from all over Africa, with over 20,000 applicants from 54 African countries and territories. With support from Accenture and the Pan-African Selection Committee, we picked 1,000 amazing entrepreneurs from 52 African countries. These 1,000 are now in the midst of a 12-week online business skills training program and have been paired with 400 expert mentors from across the world. In July, they will come from all corners of Africa to Lagos for a boot camp, where they will complete their training, receive their first checks, and build Pan-African network that will last them a lifetime. Last week, I was at the White House in Washington, D.C. to support President Obama's Global Entrepreneurship Initiative called SPARC. I was invited to speak about my vision for how entrepreneurship can transform Africa, including a focus on the Tony Elumelu Foundation Entrepreneurship Program, which I just talked about. The following day, I gave a keynote address at Georgetown University titled Entrepreneurship-Led Development, where I spoke specifically about how entrepreneurship represents a bottom-up approach to development, the kind of small, young entrepreneurs supported by my foundation. I have focused extensively on entrepreneurship in my life because it is the beginning of the story of how private enterprise can empower the development of Africa. After all, a healthy and resilient business ecosystem has a spectrum of enterprises, from the small entrepreneurial venture all the way up to the large established multinational companies. Today, I will focus on what already established businesses can do to advance Africa development through an economic philosophy that I call Afri-capitalism. Afri-capitalism centers around the private sector's critical role in driving economic and social development across Africa. In this context, my focus will not be on individual entrepreneurs, but on what the large established companies in Africa or those planning to come into Africa can do to maximize private sector's development dividend. Currently, African and donor governments preoccupy themselves with developing the right aid programs and the right level of spending in each sector to advance development. The OECD countries aim to set aside 0.7% of their national budgets for international development. On the African side, our government debate what percentage of their federal budgets to allocate to the various sectors of greatest social need. 5% for health, according to the Abuja Declaration, and 10% for agriculture, according to the Maputo Declaration, for example. Governments are the key players in the official aid flows, aided, of course, by philanthropists and non-profit service organizations. For example, last year, Africa received a total of $56 billion in official development assistance, that is ODA, and a few billion more in philanthropic assistance. This is a new high watermark for total ODA to Africa in a single year. However, even with the aid at record levels and billions more in philanthropic funds, it is still dwarfed by the total amount of annual private international capital flows into Africa. Last year, the FDI to Africa was $57 billion, a billion more than we received in official bilateral multilateral aid. When we combine remittances and intra-African investments with FDI, we are talking of nearly $200 billion in private capital a year, and rising, and this is also going up. This is already having an impact on development on our continent. But with a more deliberate effort to drive a new kind of private sector investment model, this could have an even greater impact for the continent. So my point this evening is simple. We need to expand the pool of development actors and expand our development mechanisms to enable all actors to participate in a way that is congruent with the way they naturally function. Large national and multinational companies across Africa, both African and foreign owned, are creating hundreds of thousands of jobs in multiple countries and integrating the continent more and more each day. According to a World Bank study, Africa's private sector accounts for about 2/3 of total investment, 4/5 of total consumption, and 3/4 of total credit on the continent. This all adds up to increased development based on economic opportunity. The private sector needs to be recognized and charged with being a key player in not just Africa's development generally, but in Africa's development agenda, deliberately and specifically. This is what I have been preaching, and this is what I call Afrocapitalism. Afrocapitalism is an economic philosophy that promotes long-term investment in strategic sectors that will create economic and social wealth. That is, financial returns for shareholders as well as the social dividends for society. Although Africa received a record amount of FDI last year, a recent article in the Financial Times estimates that 1/3 of that investment still flowed into extractive-based projects. This is why Afrocapitalism as an approach is so important to Africa's economic and social future. In practice, Afrocapitalism advocates for more local value creation instead of the extraction model. Intra-African trade and investment, regional integration, and development of our local human capital and other capacities that will drive Africa forward and aid development. As part of the global effort to reconsider the role of business in society, there are a number of movements with similar aims to Afrocapitalism, one of which I'm a member and supporter, and it's called Inclusive Capitalism. This is championed by Tony Elumelu Foundation Advisory Board member, Lady Lynn Rothschild, and McKinsey's Managing Director Dominic Barton. Inclusive capitalism is, of course, like the capitalism we all know, but a version in which the benefits are more widely shared by all. We also have Professor Michael Porter of the Harvard Business School, and also a founding patron of the Tony Elumelu Foundation. He promotes the concept of shared value, which is the belief that the competitiveness of a company and the health of the communities around it are mutually dependent. And there is Dr. Jim Kim, president of the World Bank, who also talks about shared prosperity, which is the necessity of achieving broad-based economic growth that permeates all levels of society, not just a small elite subset, but the case with commodity, as is usually the case with commodity-dependent economies. African capitalism brings all these concepts together because African capitalism is about shared purpose. African capitalism therefore means we cannot leave the business of development to our governments, donor countries, and philanthropic organizations alone. The private sector must be involved in the business of development, especially on the African continent. We in the African private sector must wake up, recognize, and embrace our role in driving the economic growth and social development of Africa. And we must act on that responsibility in tangible ways. We must do this, not just through philanthropy and CSR practices that have inherited from Western companies or practices, but by the way we run our businesses and the types of investment choices we make every day. As we strive for greater financial returns, the development dividend must intrinsically be part of the strategic calculations that we make. And we must think in the long term, because the kinds of challenges we face on the continent require not only vision, but also patience and perseverance. I am the chairman of SODs, and we practice what we preach. We are a Pan-African company that invests in the key strategic sectors of power, oil and gas, financial services, real estate and hospitality, agriculture, and healthcare. All of these for the long term, and all with the aim of creating value within our own economies. Let me share with you my personal experience of how the practice of African capitalism in the financial services, power, and agriculture sectors has buttressed my belief that private companies do indeed create financial and social impact in their chosen sectors and geographies. In 1997, my partners and I took over the Shuttered Crystal Bank and rebranded it into Standard Trust Bank. We were small, but outperforming most of the other banks in Nigeria across a variety of financial metrics. We achieved unprecedented growth through innovation and by pursuing down-market customers who had not previously had bank accounts. This approach fueled an amazing growth trajectory for the bank, but also helped to create a culture of responsibility and accountability, helped to facilitate payments and open up access to credit for tens of thousands of financially disenfranchised Nigerians at the time. Though economic profit was our primary motivation at the time, we democratized access to banking, first in Nigeria, and then across Africa in the process. This had a formidable impact on my understanding of how business, even in pursuit of profit, can indeed simultaneously deliver a meaningful social return as well. The success of STB Standard Trust Bank allowed us to merge with the much larger United Bank for Africa UBA in 2005. However, we had the vision of expanding financial inclusion beyond Nigeria and facilitating intra-African transactions. So we opened bank subsidiaries in 18 other African countries and allowed customers in some previously underbanked economies to open bank accounts with zero balances. That strategic calculation to be patient and to democratize access to banking services did pay off. And so today, United Bank for Africa has over 7 million customers across Africa, operating in 19 African countries, supported by over 20,000 employees, and through the financial platforms that we have created and transactions that we orchestrate on a daily basis, we are indeed facilitating regional integration and development on the continent. For our Pan-African growth strategy, this was part of the equation. The social impact that would be created through a Pan-African financial institution was something we were aiming for. The story is fully documented for you all to read in an upcoming publication called Africans Investing in Africa, which was co-funded by my foundation and the Oppenheimer's Benthos Foundation. And interestingly, there's an the introduction was done by your own Professor Paul Collier. So look out for it. Making financial services available to the unbanked in Nigeria and across Africa is shared purpose, and that is Africapitalism. In the power sector, S. Holdings recognized that over half of Nigeria's population of 170 million lacks access to power of any kind, and we as a country only generate 10% of the 40,000 megawatts that we need to power our domestic consumption needs. So one of our subsidiaries, Transcom, acquired a plant that was producing only 160 megawatts of its 1,000 megawatt installed capacity under government control and doubled the output within 4 months of us taking over ownership in November 2014. This plant, or this our power investment, now operates at 610 megawatts every day, and we are currently upgrading and expanding the plant to generate 2,000 megawatts with partners like General Electric. Our ambition is to generate 25% of the country's power supply, regardless of total generating capacity in the country. We made this investment with the intent of realizing profit for our shareholders, but also to unlock other economic opportunities, like new businesses and expansions which create new jobs, all of which will come as a result of reliable and affordable access to power and lower operating costs for businesses, especially the SMEs. We know megawatts on this grid means more electricity for homes, and it means more electricity for hospitals. It means more electricity for businesses, and equally as important, more electricity to enable homework to be done at night by our kids. And we are doing it within the framework of the National Power Plan. So to us at S. Holdings, what is good for S. Holdings is good for our society. And that is Africapitalism to us. The last experience I would like to share is in the agriculture sector, which is a strategic sector in just about any African country, though unfortunately normally treated as a social sector rather than one with real business opportunities. We know that 70% of employed people in Africa work in the agriculture sector, and agriculture accounts for about 30% of the GDP of most African countries. Yet, are farmers who provide the very sustenance that fuels our bodies, our creativity, and our economies, are some of the poorest among us. With the recognition that 50% of the population gains by 2050 will come from Africa, and that the AU, the African Union member countries, have prioritized the agricultural sector, we, the Exogenes Group, as a company invested along with Nicholas Berggren, an American investor, in Africa Exchange Holdings, APEX, to establish commodity exchanges in key markets across Africa. We started with the East African Exchange, EAX, in Rwanda, leveraging the amazing enabling environment that has been put in place by President Kagame and his team, and then expanded to Nigeria, where we recently became the first private company to secure a commodity exchange license in the country. We are planning to expand to other markets like Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania over the next few months. The story of FX and EAX is very interesting. These companies place our smallholder farmers at the center of our business model because they are the most critical actors in any food security strategy for the continent. Our model was to create commercial platforms that will help farmers to reduce post-harvest losses through warehousing, give them access to multiple and competing buyers in more markets, help provide farmers with access to credit and financial products, thus making them bankable, and help give manufacturers a reliable supply of raw materials and quality assurance, and thereby encouraging them to buy more from these farmers on the continent. Our activities also stimulate financial services and manufacturing industries. And we're doing it by treating agriculture not as a social service, but as business. Not a welfare program, by treating the small farmers as business, but we're treating the small farmers as business partners. We're not treating them or dealing with them as charities. The overall effect of this business model is to increase farmers' income in a more sustainable manner than any aid program can transform their lives. Another example from outside the Exogenes Group is that of a company called Dangote Industries in the world now, Africa. This company's case is also another interesting one. This company used to be the largest importer of cement, and numerous other basic commodities in Nigeria. However, since they converted their operations to local manufacturing and began creating significant local value, they have not only grown to become the biggest company listed on Nigerian Stock Exchange, creating thousands of jobs in Nigeria, but their model has increased demand for their product, and they are now operating in 6 different African countries. This is shared purpose. And that is Afrocapitalism. The beauty of Afrocapitalism is that it is not restricted to only indigenous African businesses, though as African business leaders, we must set examples for others to follow. Some multinationals have already followed this path in Africa, and I recently heard a case study of 2 multinational FMCG companies in Nigeria who 30 years ago had roughly equal same market share. One of the companies invested significantly in local manufacturing and linking to domestic supply chains, while the other maintained an import-driven model. The company that invested locally is now 7 times the size of the one that did not. And the laggard company is now struggling to catch up. investing in local manufacturing and also linking to local supply chains. Afrocapitalism is really the way in which all existing and future local and foreign investors can and should develop their investment plans for Africa. They must separate themselves from the traditional investors who have collectively extracted trillions of dollars worth of riches from beneath the African soil or grown in the African soil, while delivering little to no enduring tangible opportunities for the economic advancement of the millions living on the surface. To be clear, the shared purpose inherent in African capitalism does not by any way absolve government of their role in advancing development. In fact, shared purpose means everyone has a role: business, government, philanthropists, NGOs, and multilateral institutions alike. African capitalism is the nexus between the ability of the private sector to create value and government's creation of a business-friendly environment. These two roles must become further intertwined and even mutually dependent and mutually reinforcing to create an equitable, inclusive, and prosperous Africa. Now I want to briefly talk about how companies can create this virtuous cycle of development through economic empowerment. Many companies, particularly those in commodity-dependent economies, need to redouble their efforts to incorporate emerging local entrepreneurs into the value chain of their businesses. This not only helps to create jobs and build local capacity, it also helps to insulate their businesses from breaks in their supply chain caused by external shocks. Take Coca-Cola, for instance. This company has pursued a concerted strategy of sourcing juice, concentrate, and other raw material for its beverages in local markets across Africa. This is creating opportunities for local fruit growers, aggregators, and transporters, while also supporting local agri-processing and the local beverage industry. It has helped create entire supply chains of entrepreneurs where there was formerly none. I'm proud to say that Transcor's agribusiness subsidiary Terragro, the first company in Nigeria to process our abundant oranges, pineapples, and mangoes into concentrate, is the most recent addition to the Coca-Cola local supply chain in Africa. Coca-Cola, Transcor, and Dangote Cement's activities are examples of local value creation, a key pillar of African capitalism. Companies that incorporate local value creation will both be more sustainable and more profitable in Africa in the long run. In addition to investing in local economies and creating local jobs, they are also increasing the pool of those who can afford their products and services. In conclusion, African capitalism is a call for businesses to make decisions that will increase economic and social wealth and promote development in communities and nations in which they operate. Such a decision will ultimately help businesses become more profitable as the communities they serve become well-off consumers, healthy consumers, and better educated employees, and even entrepreneurs who go on to become suppliers and service providers and consumers as well. So, as students who will soon be entering the workforce, your generation is a lot more conscious of the way in which business is conducted than any generation before you. This, of course, is expected considering the fact that you live in a time when the Earth's population is stretching our resources to the limit, and when income inequality is more pronounced than ever. If you do not care about how business is conducted, your very futures may also be at stake. What kind of employer do you want to be? Do you want to be the employer that maximizes short-term profits by taking the shortest route to profitability? uncaring, or sometimes even to the detriment of the local community you operate in. Or one that takes a longer term view and that practices patience in the pursuit of profit while building up the capacity of the community. And as consumers, who would you want to buy your products from? As investors, who would you want to invest your capital in? African capitalism's call to action is to use your power as individuals, employees, employers, investors, and consumers, and for almost all of you and all of us, leaders in the public, private, and social sectors, to support the kind of business practices, especially on the African continent, that lift up society whilst making profits. You are the world's future leaders. And the most important determinant of African capitalism's success or failure can be boiled down to that single but complex imperative that we all talk about every time: leadership. A true leader is one who remains committed to a higher purpose that most others do not yet see. And that is why African capitalism is about shared purpose. The old business model of a myopic pursuit of profit above all else is at best imprudent and at worst reckless in our increasingly interconnected and interdependent world. As future leaders, you must therefore shape how businesses need to change in order to address the complex challenges of the 21st century, not just for Africa, but for the entire world. It will not be easy, but nothing worth having ever is. I wish you well. Thank you.
So I think we have time for a few questions. So if you want to raise your hands, if you can introduce yourself to the speaker so he knows who he's speaking to, that would be great. And again, we'll have time for two or three. So is there a microphone somewhere? Yeah, right there. Okay. Why don't we begin over here? This gentleman in blue.
My name is Stephen Osubeni. I'm a student at Oxford. My question is, we understand the private sector's role in Afro-capitalism, but what exactly does the government do? What's the government's role in Afro-capitalism? Thank you.
Maybe we'll take three comments, and we'll respond to three comments.
Sure. Okay. How about this woman here in the second row? And then we'll find somebody in the back next.
Hi, my name is Mandele. I'm founder of Welcome to Africa. I'm actually running a trade investment summit that's focused on agriculture taking place in Ghana. And what we found was that smallholders are generally not attractive to financial institutions, both in the UK and in Africa and all over the world. Smallholders aren't that attractive. My question is, how can that be changed over time? How can we make smallholders attractive to financial institutions across the globe and in Africa as well?
So let's try one more question in the back, perhaps the gentleman back there. And then Tony, if you'll take those three.
Sure. Hi, thank you. Sorry, thank you very much for the talk. I found that very inspirational, and I think my friends did as well. My question has to do with the point you raised about sustainable development. And I'm wondering what you think local economies can do to improve their absorptive capacity as FDI inflows continue to increase, and at the same time that they remain not too dependent on transnational corporations in this process.
Okay,
so I start with the first one. Is it Steven? This first one, the role of government, I actually talked about it, that government has a key role to play in helping to create the enabling environment. So all the things we're talking about, for some of these things to happen, government has a key role to play. Even policies, authorizations. We are in power sector today because the government of Nigeria decided to privatize or to put the right regulatory environment that will enable private sector to enter that space. So we need government to do things like that, to create the right environment so that private sector will come in to help. But government should also realize, and we're preaching that, that the job of government is not really to create jobs per se, but they need to create the ecosystem that will usher in, enable the private sector moving and help government create jobs. But the second point on the SMEs, the smallholders, you know, at the Tony Elumelu Foundation, when we set up TIP for us, $100 million is a lot of money, but in a way also, it's not so much because of the kind of capital requirements on the continent. What we are giving to people beyond capital is actually the mentoring, the training, you know, teaching people, creating the ecosystem that allows SMEs to succeed, knowledge, you know, how to do things, you know, how to set up your records, your financial account records, etc., and how to engage the right staff, work with the right staff, put the right policies, building the organization to succeed to last. Those, if you do those things, you automatically become attractive to banks. Okay, and we don't have many angel funds there. Or patient, that's why I want to talk about patient capital. We don't have many people interested in investing on the continent at this point in time. But we believe, and that again is one of the reasons we decided to do what we're doing through the Tony Elumelu Entrepreneur Program, that these 1,000 first year people, and in fact, all say 10,000, the greatest gift to them is not actually the $10,000 each we give to them. The greatest gift is the platform, the networking platform we create for them, cleaning them up and making them attractive to people to come and invest in them. That is what we order. So that is what others also need, other the small SMEs on the continent. And progressively, as we see success stories out of these SMEs, banks and other international capital managers will begin to look in that direction to benefit from it. But what is key is economic success, economic opportunity, and not just about grant. You can give grant to SMEs forever and they won't make much progress. That's why what we do is about helping to create, to empower people and let them become entrepreneurs who can make things, who can succeed. The third point about the local economies, there's a lot. So part of what the local economy should do also is the local authorities, government at that level, making sure that the operating environment is good, that will attract the FDI. Money, a lot of people want FDI to come to their country. So if you don't prepare your country for it, you know, the FDI will not come to your country. So I would say what should be done is to develop, have good training institutions so that people, employees, you have well-trained employees, have good laws and good laws, have sound policies, have predictability in government practices and actions, and I think capital will find its way to such environments.
So, perhaps one more.
Oh, okay.
Okay. I'm sorry, careful.
Okay, so let's give to her. My neighbor here.
Oh. I got lucky. Thank you. My name is Ricky Asimota from London Business School. So you touched on the role of government in sort of Afrocapitalism. My question is really specific examples of incentives that the government maybe has in promoting the private sector to engage in Afrocapitalism, but even more so, any sort of de-incentivizing of short-termism in the private sector.
You know, the private sector space, you don't regulate. Okay, so it depends on the sectors you play, you can regulate. But to a large extent, anyway, I think maybe tax incentives, if government can work out the mechanism very well, but in a way that it's not abused by people claiming that they are investing long-term, meanwhile it's not long-term. I think if you look at what the government of Nigeria did in power space, in a way that is also actually promoting, incentivizing this kind of behavior. So investing in power space, because they wanted to attract, you know, it's highly capital intensive, investing in PowerSpace, they decided to grant a tax holiday, I think 15 years in tranches of 5 years. Also, when we wanted as a country to attract the MTN, the telecommunication company to the country and other telecommunication companies, they were also giving, I think, a 5-year tax holiday so that they can come to invest. So you can structure some of these incentives so that the incentives create the kind of behavior that we want. But actually, it's a great question that is worth researching if you ask. So we can structure incentives to align with the kind of behavior we want in the, by maybe if it's tax, make it long-term, depending on the sector you're creating. So if telecommunication is key for the country, you can give incentives in that area to attract people. If power is important as it is, it can give long-term. So I think such incentives can also help to encourage the right behavior in the private sector. Thank you.